Topic is, as you know, BRS, tips and tricks. Well, as you know that BRS has fallen into a lot of controversy in the last 1 year. In fact, the major supplier of BRS, the Abbott, has even withdrawn on their own with this technology in this form. But Merrill Life Sciences has got a BRS which we call the second generation BRS, which possibly can obviate some of the issues, of the existing or the BRS which most of us have used. Now, we all know that we hate to see pictures like this. You can see this diffuse instant restenosis of a metal drug eluting stent. And then you see you have done such a good job, trifurcation stenting and follow up. Sometimes you are so disheartened to see results like this. So we don't want to see results like this. We also know that we are mentally tuned to have to live with this kind of histological results. Eosinophilic infiltrates, inflammation, delayed healing, vessel remodeling, and new atherosclerosis. So there always has been a desire that if we could have a stent which does its job and goes away. We always have had these technological issues. Like in 2002, I don't know how many of you were doing PCIs that time, but I was. Now, we came out with first generation drug eluting stents, and that was a big innovation. And there was so much of enthusiasm that we thought that we have won everything, and the big interventional cardiologists said that, you know, just stent it and forget about it. But then we started seeing harsh realities of thrombosis, and in one of the Barcelona European Society meetings, this was highlighted, and Salim Yusuf said that drug-eluting stents are like ticking bombs inside your hearts, which can explode any time. So a lot of thoughtful adaptations came, and we came out with now second generation and third generation metal drug eluting stents, thinner struts, better polymers, biodegradable polymers, very, you know, acceptable drugs, the Limus group of drugs. So that's how we are used to, you know, getting enthusiasm, getting hit on the wrong side and coming out with something new. That's what happened with BRS, which is now a reality. We have it. The current generation BRS, which all of us know, and I think most of you have used it, are not user-friendly devices. They're thick struts, high profiles. You need special tips and tricks for implantation. Expansion characteristics are limited. Accessibility to side branches is difficult. You can't see it. Radio opacity is so poor. Radial strength is unpredictable. And then the major issue of the scaffold thrombosis, which was seen in the 3-year follow-up data of Absorb, IDA study and other studies, which have, you know, led us to rethink about what should be done to this technology. But that also means that we need next generation devices. We should not abandon the idea, because the idea intuitively is so good. And with these thoughts in mind, Merris developed a 100 millimicrons BRS, which has a hybrid cell technology, closed cells at the edges and open cells in the middle, which gives it a very good trackability. The backbone of the scaffold is PLLA, and the thickness is just 100 millimicrons. The drug coated on this is sirolimus with a PLA polymer, and the markers on the edges are very unique. The couplet of triaxial radiopaque markers and the optimal side branch access because of the open cell design is there. In addition, there are 63 sizes available with a diameter from 2.5 to 4.5 and lengths from 8 millimeters to 40 millimeters in 5 to 6 millimeter increments. The opacity of the markers is really remarkable, as you can see in this, that you can see these markers so well that it appears like a virtual tubing, and gives a operator who has used this as well as absorb, you get a much better comfort when using it because you see it in three dimensions. Now you can see this particular picture in which, you know, BRS from Meris 100 is being positioned. You can see these markers. The proximal most marker is the balloon marker, whereas the marker next to it is the marker of the end of the stent. So you can really precisely place it at the ostium, as you can see in this particular case. We all know the rationale why we want a good BRS, because we don't want permanent metal in the artery. It cracks, it rusts, it leads to inflammation, and we don't want foreign body to be there if possible. We also want that the integrity of the coronary artery should be preserved so that it behaves like a normal coronary artery. The cage goes away, the vasodilatation to various drugs and physiological stimuli continues. When it first was thought of, we thought that we will be able to reduce the duration of dual antiplatelet therapy. Unfortunately, that dream did not seem to be true, because now we know that till the time BRS has not completely dissolved or disappeared or resorbed, we need to give them dual antiplatelet therapy. Also, in cases of instant restenosis, it is a very good thought to deploy properly a resorbable stent so that we don't have several layers of metal. It is available, but how to deal with it? We know that from our experience, some of the lesions where we should not be thinking about using it, or at least not be very excited to use it, highly calcified lesions, very tortuous vessels, left main because of a very large size and also the implications of its restenosis or occlusion, major bifurcations because we still are not comfortable using two stents in the bifurcation, and bypass grafts with very little experience, plus the sizes, the saphenous venous bypass grafts are sometimes very large and huge. So basically, we have learned from experience that if we have the optimal BVS implantation technology, and that should be there even with the newer generation BVS, and all the companies are working feverishly to produce a new generation BVS. So first of all, we have to prepare the lesion, possibly with a non-compliant balloon. 1:1 balloon is to reference vessel diameter ratio, because we can't falter on that. Properly size the vessel. Don't be in a rush to put in a stent. Produce maximum vasodilatation. Use intracoronary nitroglycerin. Image if necessary. Balloon sizing is critical. And plan to upsize the scaffold for any reference vessel diameter. If you see the reference vessel diameter is 3, maybe we use a 3.5 millimeter stent. Expansion limits of any of these stents, because they are plastic stents, has to be kept in mind, because one has to stay within the nominal size of up to 0.5 millimeter, increment every 5 seconds, maintain the target pressure for 30 seconds, expand it very slowly, one or two atmospheres every 30 seconds, so that the force is transmitted to the stent, to this plastic stent, slowly. And finally, after deploying it, before imaging it again, we must post dilate it with a non-compliant balloon at a very high pressure, and we should aim at a residual stenosis which is less than 10% after scaffold implantation. And it appears that till we get full confidence, the role of imaging, especially OCT or IVUS, whatever you are comfortable with, will be very good to make sure that all the struts have been deployed against the wall and there is no malalignment. Let me give you an example of a young female with multiple risk factors who had chest pain intermittently with some STT changes, and as you can see, a focal LED lesion. Now, after deploying a BVS, after making the bed and everything, you can see angiographically it looks quite good, quite acceptable. But if you see the IVUS, you can see in the lower panel there is incomplete expansion and there is a gap between the vessel wall and the stent struts. So one has to go again, post dilate it with a bigger balloon at very high atmospheres. The angiographic result remains the same, but the OCT result much better. The area which was around 5.4 has become now 6.4, and one can see that the struts are symmetrically opposed, although the asymmetrical stent expansion is still there because of the vessel fibrosis. This is another patient which we did, and this is a patient who actually wanted a BRS because BRS was in vogue that time, and as you can see, is a little longish lesion coming up to the ostium. And we prepared the bed 1:1, high pressure, and then we're deploying the stent. And you can see this meristent, as I showed you, the markers really help you very well in positioning, especially at the ostium. And deploy at the nominal pressure, but then go ahead and go with a balloon, bigger balloon, higher pressure, go up to 20 atmosphere, make sure that you are within the stent, and for this, very good markers really help you. And this is what we got. Now, the OCT post-deployment is always very encouraging. As you can see in this particular patient, there's a complete apposition of all the struts. You can see the struts which are thick, although much thinner than the absorbed. These are 100 millimicron struts, and you can also see that it is asymmetric in the proximal region because of lot of fibrosis here, which does not allow the vessel to expand completely, but it is up to the intima, so the apposition is good. And this is the 1 year follow-up of this patient, which looks pristine. Now, BRS for long lesions, because say sometimes you have to put these two stents side to side, we don't like to have the apposition like we do in metal stents because of the thickness of the struts. So you will have too much of two struts, two layer of struts in that small portion, which is to be avoided. So there again you see the proximal edge of the stent and the distal edge of the other stent have to be just adjacent to each other rather than overlapping. And in this, stent boost can help you very well. As you can see the stent enhancement, you see the markers very well. This is the balloon marker and this is the stent markers. So the other stent which you are bringing should be somewhere here, so that it is just lying adjacent to it. And for this, the radio opaque marker of the Meris is very good. As you can see, this is the scaffold proximal radio opaque marker, and there is 1.3 millimeter of stent beyond it. And this is the balloon marker, which is very close to it, and the balloon overhang is only 0.1 millimeter. So if you bring the second stent just up to this point, then they're just lying adjacent, very close to each other, and you are not really overlapping them. So new generation drug-eluting stents are available on shelf of various sizes. I must say that industry and researchers are working very hard to bring next generation BRS. The BRS performance has been shown to be satisfactory in selected patient group with selected lesions. And next generation thin strut devices have better deliverability and early outcomes, as has been seen by most of the operators who have used both the generations. I'd like to conclude that currently available BRS need a very meticulous implantation technique. Those principle of 4P has to be adhered to, and absorb 4, which is still going on, and this 4P is being used. And I am told that so far, whatever follow up we have and follow up by the DSMBs, things are going okay. We should start our experience, if we do not have much experience with this, with simpler lesions. Assistance of intravascular imaging system is extremely helpful. But I must say that we have to show advantages over new generation metallic drug-eluting stents. It has to be demonstrated convincingly. Otherwise, why should this technology be embraced? Because if there is no particular long-term advantage, with all the scare and high strut thickness, even if it has come down to 100, it's still much more than 50 and 60. So I think future is bright, and we should be patiently waiting. And as things come on, use our sense and use this technology, but at the same time, look for and wait for the data to come. Thank you very much.
Excellent presentation, Dr. Kaul, and I think really very important actually is what you've shown is that imaging plays a great role, even though angiographically that patient that you had, extremely a 35-year-old woman, did not have any residual stenosis by angiography, but still on OCT it was 5.4 and with post-dilatation went to 6.4.
Yes.
And from our previous mistakes, we have to learn, rather than just globally not using OCT for with absorb, actually resulted in it being removed. Now probably, do you agree that we probably to take the other objective and say that we do recommend OCT in majority of these patients?
That's right. Yeah, I think it's extremely important.
Any questions from the audience?
And we also have to wait to see the advantages of this technology. Yeah.
You're right.
I would like to know about the antiplatelet therapy. How do he recommend for these patients? How long?
Yeah, sure. See, when it started, it was thought that it will shorten the antiplatelet therapy, dual antiplatelet therapy. But unfortunately, after seeing the midterm and long-term results, continuing to see 1 to 2% of scaffold thrombosis, and also having got more science into it, that the degrading material of PLA, the polyglycan and other things, are quite thrombogenic. So it is now believed that till the time the scaffold is completely resorbed, we need to have a dual antiplatelet therapy. Whether ticagrelor alone is going to be as good and may replace dual antiplatelet therapy, that has to be seen. But as of now, I think potent antiplatelet therapy has to be continued for 2 to 3 years, and that is the average time in which these stents get absorbed.
Question. No, it's just a comment. Great presentation, Dr. Kaul. The only thing is that Greg Stone presented at TCT in a specific group of patients using systematically IVUS, OCT, all following all the steps. And even with that, the results were worse randomized compared to the regular standard science stent. So. We don't know what is going to happen in the next few years.
I mean, did they achieve a minimal scaffold area of more than 6?
Exactly. Okay. Using OCT, IVUS, perfect preparing the lesion, all centers with experience, and even with that, the results were slightly worse in terms of clinical outcomes.
That's right. That's very good. That's right. That's what has dampened the enthusiasm, yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kaul, again, and we will move on with the next lectures. Thank you very much.
Certainly. Good. All the best. Have a nice evening.